Good morning, sixth grade. I'm at home with our book. This week, we are actually only going to read chapters 25 through 28. It's a little bit shorter, simply because we are finishing up the section Thieves. Remember, they labeled the train car of the people, calling them thieves and criminals in order to keep people from helping them. And so we're going to finish up that section of the book. The next section is called Maps and Snakes. So we're going to start that one next week. When we get together, we have lots of things to discuss on Friday. So we'll go over that new section and our plan moving forward. But today we're going to go over our read chapter 25. Through 28. I am going to post your questions after I'm done reading today. Some of the questions that I have for you are, I want you to give me some more explanation with your answers. So the first one is, Lena's group is not sold. Remember, they were sitting in the field waiting and watching people be sold to these really rough looking characters that came in wagons. And so when they were sold, they were loaded into the wagons and took through the mountain pass. So we don't know who these rough characters really were. We just know that we didn't want to be part of it. What happened to them? So what's going to happen to Lena and her family when they're not sold? They're going to go somewhere. And so we're going to find all of that out here. And so you'll see in the on all of the different places that I post, you will find the video, and you're going to have some vocabulary words to kind of help explain some of the words that they're using in the book, just in case you don't understand the context or the definition of what they might be using it for, as well as your questions for reading. So let's get started. Chapter 25. Evening came and two groups were left. Most of the NKVD had departed with the train. Only five armed officers remained with two trucks. Nearly 75 Lithuanians and only 5 Soviets, yet no one dared to move. I think most of us were too tired and weak. The grass was a welcomed bed, the space a luxury. I made note of the landmarks to draw for Papa. The NKVD made a fire and cooked their dinner while we sat and stared. They had American canned goods, bread, and coffee. After dinner, they drank vodka and smoked, the volume of their voices rising steadily. What are they saying? I asked Mother. They're talking about their homes, where they're from. They're sharing stories about their friends and family. I didn't believe her. I listened to the Russian words, the tone of their voices, and the cackling laughter. Didn't sound like talk of family at all. Ona began again. She had taken to chanting, no, 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 over and over. One of the NKVD stood up and yelled, flipping his hands at our group. I better try to quiet her, said Mother, getting up before the guards could become angry. Jonas was already asleep, and I covered him with my blue raincoat and wiped his hair away from his eyes. The bald man snored. The gray-haired man, that he just kept winding his wristwatch. Andreas sat at the edge of the group, one knee pulled up to his chest, watching the guards. He had a strong profile and an angular jaw. A piece of disheveled hair fell perfectly against the side of his face. I needed a soft pencil to draw it. He saw me staring, and I turned away quickly. Hey, he whispered to me. I looked up. Something rolled across the grass and hit my leg. It was the stone with the sparkles he had found that day when he had jumped off the train. The crown jewel from the train car, Princess, I whispered, smiling. He nodded with a laugh. I picked it up and rolled it back to him. No, you keep it, said Andreas. We woke at sunrise. With a few hours later, a wagon came, chose the other group, and took them away. The guards then loaded us back in the back of two trucks, and drove across the valley beyond the notch in the hills where the road began. No one spoke. We were too frightened to discuss our possible destination. Riding in the truck, I realized that trying to escape would have been ridiculous. There was nothing for miles. We didn't see a human being or pass another vehicle. I thought about the man who had my handkerchief, hoping it was passed along, moving closer to Papa. After 2 hours, we saw huts dotting the sides of the road. We entered what appeared to be an inhabited area, and the truck pulled over in front of a wooden building. The guards jumped out, yelling, "Divide! Divide!" and other instructions. They say we should leave our luggage in the trucks, Mother said, clutching her coat tightly over her arm. I want to know where we're going before we get out, demanded Mrs. Arbidos. Mother tried to talk to the guards. She turned and smiled. It's a bathhouse. We jumped off the truck and Mother folded her coat and put it in her suitcase. The guards split us into male and female groups. Boys, carry me, said the bald man to Andreas and Jonas. You have to bathe me. Jonas looked petrified. Andreas, disgusted. I smiled, which seemed to annoy Andreas even more. The men went first. The guards called them up to the porch and began yelling in their faces, pushing them, and Jonas looked at Mother for translation. Take off your clothes, dear, Mother translated. Now, right here? Jonas asked, looking at all of the women and girls. We'll all turn around, won't we, ladies, said Mother. We all turned around with our backs to the porch. No use in being modest now, said Mr. Stallus. We're nothing but skeletons. Now help me with my pants, boy. Watch my leg. I heard Mr. Stallus complaining as Jonas was apologizing. A belt buckle knocked against the wood of the porch, and I wondered if it was Andreas's. The guards yelled. He says you must leave your clothes there and that they will be deloused, said Mother. Something smelled funny. I couldn't tell if it was the same coming from our group of women or from the bathhouse. We heard the bald man yell from within the structure. Mother turned around and clasped her hand together. My sweet Jonas. So, being deloused is getting rid of lice. That's one of the vocabulary words that you'll find in your list, which all the definitions are there for you, so don't worry. All right, chapter 26. We waited. What's going on in there? I said. Mother shook her head. 3 NKVD stood on the porch. One barked yet another command. 10 of us at a time, said Mother. We must go to the porch and take off our clothes. We were in the first group, along with Mrs. Arvidas, the grouchy woman, and her daughters. Mother helped Ona up to the porch. I unbuttoned my dress and pulled it over my unbraided hair, and took off my sandals. Mother stood there in her underwear, helping Ona. The guards stood on the porch staring at us. I hesitated. It's okay, dear, said Mother. Think of how nice it will feel to be clean again. Ona began to whimper. A young blonde guard lit a cigarette, turned his back, and looked off toward the truck. Another NKVD just stared, grinning at all of us. I stood there on the porch trying to cover myself with my hands, and Mrs. Arbidas stood next to me. She was voluptuous and way too large to conceal herself with her thin forearm. A guard with a gold tooth, who appeared to be the commander, walked down the porch, stopping to look at each woman, scanning them up and down. Ooh, what a jerk. He stopped at Mrs. Arbidas. She did not lift her head. He twirled this toothpick in his tongue and raised his eyebrow, violating her with his stare. Ooh, how creepy. I let out a breath of disgust. Mother's head snapped to me. The guard grabbed my arms and then threw them down at my sides. He looked at me and grinned. I felt his ragged fingernails scratch my arms as he grabbed me. I'd never felt this way before. He scared me and he made me feel sick. And it made me feel so awful on the inside. I tried to cross my arms and Mother yelled something in Russian and pulled me behind Ona. Ona, the poor thing, hadn't had a shower since the hospital, and so there was dried blood everywhere. The guard began to scream at my mother and she removed her remaining clothing and put her arm around me as they marched us into the bathhouse. Chapter 27. A guard stood at a distance. He plunged a scoop in the bucket and threw some sort of white powder at us. The showers clicked on with icy spray. We must hurry, said Mother. We don't know how long they'll give us. She took a small chunk of soap and scrubbed my scalp and face, ignoring her own body. I watched as brown rivers of dirt ran down my feet, down my ankles and over my feet into the drain. I wanted to be sucked down the drain with it, away from the guards and all the humiliation. Keep scrubbing, Lena, quickly, said Mother, turning to wash Ona. I stood, shivering under the stream of water, washing as well as I could, hoping the guards would not be waiting for us on the other side of the wall. I washed my mother's back and tried to wash her hair. Mrs. Arvidas stood under the stream of water, her hands raised above her head gracefully, unaware as if she were in her own private bathroom. Then the showers snapped off. We retrieved our clothes on the other side of the wall, and I quickly put my dress over my head and felt a knock against my thigh. It was the stone from Andreas. I put my hand in my pocket and my fingers searching for the smooth edge. Mother combed through my hair with her fingers. I looked at her wet face. Water dripped from her blonde waves onto her shoulders. I want to go home, I whispered, shivering. Please. She dropped her clothing and hugged me long and hard. We'll go home. Keep thinking of your father and of our house. We must keep it all alive in our hearts. She let go and looked at me. If we do, we'll get there. The men already in the first truck, another group of women and children, stood on the porch waiting as we exited. Feeling better, darling, said Mother, smiling at Jonas as she climbed in the back of the truck. She checked her suitcase for her coat. Jonas looked much improved in appearance and disposition. So did Andreas. His wet hair was shiny, the color of dark cinnamon. Now we're clean, dead men. So what of that? Said the bald man. If we were dead men, they wouldn't allow us to shower, said the gray-haired man, looking at his watch. Hey, there was blonde hair under all that dirt, said Andreas, reaching out and grabbing a strand of my hair. I shrank back and looked away. Mother put her arm around me. What's wrong, Lena? Asked Jonas. I ignored him. I thought of the guard who had grabbed my arms and all the things that I should have done. I should have slapped him and kicked him and screamed in his face. I put my hand in my pocket and I grabbed that stone from Andreas. I squeezed it as hard as I could so that I could break it. Do you suppose they'll take us for a four course meal now that we've been to the sauna? Asked Mrs. Remus. Oh, yes, a piece of Black Forest tort and cognac or two, laughed Mrs. Arbutus. I'd love a nice hot coffee, said Mother. Strong coffee, said the bald man. Wow, I never thought it could feel so good to be clean, exclaimed Jonas, looking at his hands. Everyone's humor was much improved, except Ona's. She continued chanting. Despite the efforts of Mrs. Remus, she could not be calmed. The last group of women and children boarded the truck. The commander saw Ona standing up, sitting down, standing up and sitting down and standing up and sitting down and pulling her hair. He yelled at her. The young blonde guard appeared at the back of the truck. Leave her be, said Mrs. Remus. The poor dear is grieving. Mother translated to the commander. Ona stood up and stomped her right foot. The commander stepped up and pulled Ona from the truck. She lost all control, screaming and clawing at him. She was no match for his height or strength. He threw her to the ground, his eyes narrowed, and his square jaw tightened. Mother scrambled to jump off the truck to Ona. It was too late. The commander pulled out a pistol and shot Ona in the I gasped, along with everyone else. Andreas grabbed Jonas's face and covered his eyes. Blood, the color of thick red wine, pooled under Ona's head. Her leg splayed out in a very unnatural bent angle, and one of her feet was missing a shoe. Lena, Andreas said. I turned my head to him, dazed. Don't look, he said. My mouth opened, but nothing came out. I turned my head back, and the young blonde guard was staring at Ona's body. Lena, look at me, urged Andreas. Mother slumped on her knees near the edge of the truck, looking down at Ona. I moved and sat down near my brother. The engine rumbled, and the truck began to roll. My mother sat down and put her face in her hands. Mrs. Gribus clucked her tongue, shaking her head. Oh, Jonas pulled my head against his knees and patted my hair. Please don't say anything to the guards. Don't make them mad, Lena. Ona's body got smaller and smaller as we drove away. She lay dead in the dirt, murdered by the NKVD. Somewhere hundreds of miles away, her daughter decomposed in the grass. How would her family ever know what happened to her? How would anyone know what happened to us? I would continue to write and draw whenever I had the chance. I would draw the commander firing, mother on her knees with her head in her hands, and our truck driving away, the tires spitting gravel onto Ona's dead body. Last chapter for today, chapter 28. We drove into a large collective farming area. Clusters of decrepit one-room cabins formed a shanty village. The warm sun was clearly temporary. Buildings pitched at a slant, their warped roofs warning of extreme weather. The guards ordered us off of the truck, and Andreas hung his head. Standing close to his mother, they began directing us to what I thought were our own shacks, but Mrs. Gribus and Mrs. Remus entered one, and a woman ran out and began arguing with the guards. There are people living in the cabins, whispered Jonas. Yes, we'll most likely have to share, said Mother, pulling us close. Two women walked past us carrying large buckets of water. I didn't recognize them from our train. We were assigned to a dingy hut near the back of the settlement. The gray wood was bald, shaved by many seasons of wind and snow. The door had splits in the cracks and sat crooked on the frame. A strong wind would whisk the shack up, into the sky, shattering it and busting it into pieces. The blonde-haired guard pulled the door open.
What are you talking to?
I'm reading on live.
Bye. Are you talking to your kids?
Yes, I'm talking to my kids. They're listening to my video. Bye. The blonde-haired guard pulled the door open, bellowed something in Russian, and pushed us inside. A squat Alsatian woman, wrapped in layers, ran to the door and began screaming after the guard. Mother moved us to a corner. The woman turned and began yelling at us. Her hair poked out of her kerchief like black straw. Wrinkles formed an atlas on her wide, weathered face. What's she saying? Asked Jonas. She says she has no room for filthy criminals, said Mother. We're not criminals, I said. The woman continued her rant, throwing her arms in the air and spitting on the floor of the hut. Is she crazy? Asked Jonas. She says she barely has enough food for herself, and she's not about to share it with the criminals like us. Mother turned her back to the woman. Well, now we'll just set our things in this corner, Jonas. Put your suitcase down. The woman grabbed my hair and pulled it, yanking me toward the door to throw me out. Mother yelled, blasting the woman in Russian. She ripped the woman's hand from my head, slapped her, and pushed her away. Jonas kicked her in the shin. The Alsatian woman stared at us with angled black eyes. Her mother returned the stare. The woman let out a hearty laugh, and she asked a question. We're Lithuanian, said Mother, first speaking in Lithuanian and then in Russian. The woman gibbered. What's she saying? I asked. She says feisty people make good workers and that we will have to pay her rent. Mother continued asking questions. Pay her for what? To live in this hole in the middle of nowhere? I said. We're in Altai, said Mother. They are farming potatoes and beets. So there are potatoes to eat? Asked Jonas. Food is rationed. She said the guards oversee the farm and the workers, said Mother. I remembered Papa talking about Stalin confiscating the peasants' tools, land and tools and animals. He told... He told them the crops that they would produce and that they would be paid. I thought it was ridiculous. How could Stalin simply take something that didn't belong to him, something that a farmer and his family had worked their whole lives for? That's communism, Lena, Papa had said. The woman yelled at Mother, wagging her finger and shaking her head. She felt she left the hut. We are Kolkhoz, a collective farm. I was to become a beet farmer. I hated beets. No, we not play. Say bye-bye. Say bye-bye. Daddy, can you say bye-bye? You have to get a new box. Say bye-bye. Say bye-bye. See you later. No, don't touch my computer.